Okay, let's go ahead and regather.
Did he answer your question?
Now, the question was asked, and I'll talk about it in connection with something else later. You know, why did Mary go in the first place? She was not required because women wouldn't have been in the census, and that's true. Similarly, she would not have, there was no point in the sense of requirement that she had to ever go to the three feasts a year because women cannot sacrifice. So she would always be an observer, never a participant at the three great feasts. Nevertheless, for those, it's a little easier because of her, we just assume because of her devotion and how devout she is, she just still wants to be there at the holy city, at least watching the sacrifices take place, though she cannot be part of it. As to why she went with Joseph, we don't know. There's a lot of oddities of the story that we don't have the information anymore. And because Luke and Matthew, they give us the same basic stuff about the name, place of birth, different things, you know, the towns in Nazareth. But the exact, what's going on in the Holy Family's minds is a little, we're not always clear. For example, it's clear they're both from Nazareth when the story begins. Mary's the girl in Nazareth where the angel calls her, everything else. Joseph's betrothed there from Nazareth. They go to his hometown of Bethlehem, but how long he's lived there or not, we don't know. But they seem to live there for quite some time. They're still there when the Magi come, years later. And it's interesting that after coming back from Egypt, his first inclination is to go back to Bethlehem. And it's only because he sees who the king is there that he instead goes up back to Nazareth to settle at their hometown. Why? We don't know. As I mentioned, we may have to take the possibility that they lived under a huge cloud of shame and dishonor in their hometown. That wasn't where they really felt like going back if they had to make the choice themselves, but God makes it for them. But even that's simply speculation. We don't know why. So I can't answer that for the one of why she would have attended with him. But for whatever, it's there where Jesus is actually born. He's referred to as her firstborn son. That doesn't mean anything that people attach to it, except under the law, the firstborn is a legal status under the law. It is not indicative of any other children. If you are an only child and you're a male, you're the firstborn son. If you have seven older sisters and you're number eight and you're the first male, you're the firstborn son. Okay, firstborn is not a title that anyone could hold except a male, the first one who breaches the womb of that particular mom. So in a family, you would even have different firstborn sons to a man's different wives. And then of those firstborn children, he could choose which one would become his firstborn. Wow. So the whole idea of firstborn as indicating other kids or anything isn't there. We'll have to look at that. As we get closer and we see these names of relatives and stuff pop up, we'll talk about that a little more. But just at this point, recognize that the firstborn is a legal status. It's part of the idea of the Torah, because the whole Passover, remember, was the redemption of the firstborn Israelite sons. Remember, the angel of death was set to kill every firstborn son. It's only Israel saved themselves by the blood of the lamb by which the destroyer passed over their homes. So because of that, the firstborn son had a special significance in the family. And that's why not only was he circumcised like all males, but he had to be redeemed. You had to actually pay in the temple, in a sense, to respect that God had spared his life in recognition of all the firstborn sons who had been spared from Israel. Because as Israel originally worshipped, it was domestic. What I mean by that is the father was his own mini priest of his household. And his firstborn son was groomed to be his priest. And it's not until Sinai, with the sin of the golden calf, that that's ended. And then one tribe is chosen by God, the Levites, to be the priest for all Israel. And that's why you have that horrible book to try to read through, the book of Numbers, because it's numbers. But what are they trying to number? They need to number how many firstborn sons there are, because you have to allot that number of Levites to fulfill the duty that the firstborn sons lost. But you also see why Jesus can be the high priest, because he's the firstborn son according to Melchizedek, the order before Israel, when it was father to son. And there were still some remnants of that left over. When we get, we'll probably get to the finding in the temple, hopefully today. And so if we do, I'll talk about Jerusalem. When you would go up, I'll just briefly mention, you still have that imagery, even though there's real priests there now from a tribe, you still have the imagery because you would pass through various precincts of the temple. There was first a huge outer tiled area, which had no wall but had columns set up at regular intervals. That was the court of the Gentiles. And if you're a Gentile, that's as close as you could draw to the temple, under even Roman law. Roman law respected the rule. Then you would actually enter the courtyard, the larger building. And in the courtyard was what was called the court of women, because no Israelite woman or male under the age of 12 could go any further than there. And that still put you several hundred yards away, because then the next area was the court of Israelites. And that's where all Israelite males 12 and older could go as far as that. And then out of them, the two people who would, if there were two, the two people who would approach the altar would be the father and his firstborn son. And they would take their own sacrifice up the steps of the altar. The Levites would meet them there. The Levites would hand them a knife. Priests don't kill the animal. You do. It's your sacrifice. Right? I only say that because people don't have a clue. You know, I had a Protestant tell me once, well, it was meaningless ritual just like they did then. I'm like, tell that to some guy and his son trying to wrestle a 3,000-pound animal up there and slit its throat. Right? They don't think it's a meaningless ritual. So you kill the animal, the Levites, and you place it on the altar. The priest is on the other side of the altar. The Levites can't even go on the other side of the altar. And he does his part. And then below him, you have the actual temple, the little building that you would go in. And only the priests are allowed in there, the holy place. And then beyond that is the Holy of Holies, and only the high priest is allowed there. So every section of the temple is segregated. More and more are cut off the closer you get to God. The point being, why does the father and his firstborn son go up? It's still a recognition that had things not sinned, gone the way of sin, that he's still the priest of his family and his son will be his successor as priest. That's why, who does Jesus send to prepare the Passover meal and go get the lamb? Two people. Anyone remember which two? Peter and John. Peter as the father of the group of disciples, the one who was the leader, and the beloved disciple, sort of the most important one. Not firstborn in terms of literal age, but firstborn in terms of his uniqueness among the group. Which, as another aside, until more recent times, women were not allowed to cook the Passover meal. That's why Jesus sends men ahead to do it, because that was a sacred meal. That was a priestly act, and so women didn't do that one either. They could not cook that meal. I don't know what it tasted like for a guy who cooks maybe once a year, but, you know. Anyway, so, Quinn, did you have a question, Quinn?
No, I was just going to say, as in other cultures, the whole idea of firstborn son is something that's more recognized. For example, like my father is the second in line. He has an older sister. But when we went back to Vietnam, his older sister treated him as if he was the eldest and that he could do no wrong. And not that my dad thought that way. It was just the way the culture was like. And I don't know about other cultures, but at least in the Vietnamese culture.
I think
culture,
a lot of traditional cultures have more
it should be.
Authority.
Speaking of the old people. You were being recorded.
Should I leave now?
Yeah.
To that point, that's why so many second, third, fourth, and fifth born sons ended up in
priesthood and stuff,
ended
right.
Up in the military, ended up wandering around because they couldn't get any property.
Right.
All of it went to the firstborn.
That's
all
right.
Of it.
Yeah. And in under Israelite law, it was even worse than the later medieval law because the oldest son upon his father's death, the oldest son was the father of his family. That means the family, not just his wife and kids or wives and kids, but all of them. So you could be 70 years old. If your brother's 71, he tells you, and he has the force of the law behind him. If he orders you to do something, you do it. You never outgrow it. You don't become adults and you're like, oh, I can do my own thing. No, he's dad till his death. And so it's a strong, I mean, the power of the firstborn was important. Anyway, what's interesting then in the whole story is, and I'm going to skip between two, the story of the Magi and the shepherds, because the stories highlight something. In the story of the Magi, and when Jesus is born in Bethlehem, and the Magi from the east arrive, it's interesting, they said, we saw, where's the newborn king of the Jews? We saw a star at its rising, have come to do him homage. When King Herod heard this, he was greatly troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. So he gathers the chief priests, scribes, and asks them where the Messiah is going to be born. Now, then, on the other hand, and we'll look at these stories, I'll keep going back and forth. Then you have, the other hand, at the actual moment or time of Jesus' real birth, you have the shepherds in the field who encounter the angel and come to see what's going on. What we see already, which will only become clearer and clearer as Jesus' ministry progresses, is that the people who first and foremost should be acknowledging and honoring and looking forward to the birth of the Messiah, namely the elites in Jerusalem, his capital city, are all troubled by the news, right? They're not so looking forward to a ruler who's been promised. And the people who are suspect, shepherds and magi, are the ones who actually recognize and come. So you have Gentiles and scumbags. And I say that and it shocks people. That's because they don't know what a shepherd was. Lay aside the ideas of shepherd you have of some nice Irish guy with his flock out there and his brogue. That was not the Israelite shepherds. First of all, remember the time period. Most of these people do not own their own land or flocks anymore. Okay? It's owned by tenant farmers, most of whom are going to be Romans or wealthy Israelites. So it's not a little flock of sheep, it's the huge flocks. Shepherds are criminals, literally. That's how you get the job of shepherd. It saves you from a death sentence or losing a hand. So shepherds are not people you hang out with. You don't send your kids out to play with the lambs when the shepherds are around because they're all criminal. And I say that, I'm telling you the truth. So they're, see, otherwise the story is just dumb, right? It's just, oh, the shepherds, and they came and they're all like nice people and Philip Keller, 23rd Psalm. No. David was a shepherd, yeah. That was 1,000 years prior. Cultures do change, maybe not as fast as we do nowadays, but nobody lived in the year 1000 like they did in the year 1-4 BC. So you need to recognize this. The shepherds are not good people. That's what makes their love of Christ important. Otherwise, it's just sentimental. If they were already good, happy, lucky people who just love the outdoors and are kind, well, who cares then? That doesn't show anything impressive, right? No, it shows something, but because their hearts have been opened by the birth of this one who's going to come and change things. I mean, an angel appeared to them. Why would an angel appear to them? So otherwise, you need to, for the story to really resonate, you need to understand who they were and who Israel saw them as, the culture. And then the other ones are the Magi. The Magi are pagans. They're not only pagans, they're pagans from the place where Israel lived in exile, Persia and Babylon. The Magi is a name. It's where we get the word magic and magician, by the way. But it's the technical Persian term for the priest of the Zoroastrian religion. The prophet Zoroaster had arisen, I forget when, had proclaimed this new religion in the Persian Empire, which they had adopted, gotten rid of all their other gods, and they had adopted this model. There's still a few around today, just a few thousand. They're in the north of India, I think, is where they live, because they were chased out of their land by Islam a long time ago. But they were the official religion of Persia. There was a connection with astrology. They believed in two equal gods. So you could say they were bi-theists. It wasn't like God and Satan. Satan is not God. Satan is nothing that God could whip out Satan in the second if he wanted him to. Satan's a creature. God uses Satan for his plans. but there is no real competition or decision in view of who's God. That's not true for the Zoroastrians. The Persians lived a very, if you were religious, you lived a pretty stressful life because you had two gods, the good god Ahura Mazda and the bad god Engramenu, and they were equal. And what would determine whether the world ended in resurrection and life, they had the idea of resurrection too, or whether it ended in death and darkness was who won at the end. And that contest was in question, so that human beings had a duty to join the right god to make sure darkness didn't fall over the world. So this is the religion these people have. Now, they would have been familiarized with Jewish prophecies and things, because they were into that, when the Jews were captive in Babylon, in their own country. And some of these prophecies would have been written down, they would have remembered. Also, just they had the idea already that when celestial phenomenon happened, that it always signaled some approach. And for whatever, these magi, we don't know how many there are. We say three because there are three gifts, but we don't know how many there are. Anyway, they set out to sort of, this prophecy they've heard from Israel when Israel was captive in their land, they're coming to see the truth of it. Again, with them, we miss something. We immediately jump, for example, their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. We immediately jump to the true, it is true, but it is the secondary symbolic meaning of those gifts. And we say, ooh, the three gifts, gold, because he's a king, frankincense, because he's a god or a priest at least, and then myrrh, because he's going to die someday. They would have had no idea what we were talking about, right? No, what they're doing is they're putting at the feet of Jesus the tools of their trade. You see, to keep their notoriety, remember we get the word magic from them, what they would do is they would use a balsam of myrrh to smear on the paperwork. They would incense it with the frankincense so it had this beautiful smell. And then as they wrote their letters, their language, they would use gold dust to sprinkle it. Like the kids' things when you make like a glue thing and you sprinkle and only that stays on. Well, they would do that for the letter. And that's how they'd record their prophecies, so that when they did them, they'd be this beautiful big idea. Because remember, these are the state religion of this huge empire. So what they understand the gifts as being is not that. They understand that we have pagan, not only pagans, but the priesthood of pagans, ones who once ruled over Israel, are literally handing over their lives to the new Messiah. They've changed allegiances. They no longer need the tools of their pagan trade. And so the interesting story is all the Jewish people, Herod, who's half Jewish, and all the elites, the scribes, the Jerusalemites, at least the elites of Israel, can't stand what's happening. And the pagans and those who have the worst place in society among Israel are the ones who come to welcome the Messiah. And so Mary has these events happening. And when the shepherds come, they kind of tell her what's going on. And we're told, this is on page 28, upon hearing all the stuff about him that the shepherds tell her, we're told that, quote, Mary kept all these things reflecting on them in her heart. The first thing is, again, we always have to translate cultural things too, not just words. The heart is not a place for emotion for Israelites, right? That's Western Europeans. I don't know why it looks like a little double circle, our hearts, but you know, the heart for us is the place of love, not for Jews. That's your intestines. It's actually your loins, but I don't want to be graphic. So, but that's the real word, that we translate what it means into something more palatable for us. But the point being, when it says she's reflecting on her heart, it's not an emotional thing so much. The heart in Israelite thought is the source of all your thoughts, your desires, your actions, your attentions. In other words, the heart is where everything comes from, everything flows from. It's not the emotional part of you, although it'll obviously have an emotional aspect to it. But in other words, Mary is really reflecting, thinking, deciding. In the catechism, for example, we define the heart as, quote, this is at the first end of first paragraph, page 28, the depths of one's being where the person decides for or against God. It's not an emotional place, it's the place of decision. So what Mary is pictured as doing is, as she gets more information, right? First it's the angel Gabriel, then it's the spirit-filled Elizabeth. Now it's the angel's message through the shepherds. And then she'll have more, too, when she goes to Jerusalem. But as she gets each new sort of tidbit of information, she really starts to reflect on them. And in fact, the word reflect or ponder, symbalein in Greek, means literally to place side by side. So in other words, she's comparing all the stuff she's hearing. Okay? Mary's an intelligent woman. She's putting all the pieces together. She doesn't know the whole story. She knows the prophecies. She knows the basic outline of the Messiah. She knows she's the mother of the Messiah. Now she knows that God is with the Messiah in a unique way. But now she's starting to find out other things as well. And so each part of the picture, it's becoming more clearly what's going on. And so, but also the horrible conditions of his birth, the people who come to greet her, the shepherds in the field, which must have been a terrifying experience at first, right? Your newborn baby and all these dudes bust in your house like a home invasion. And all of a sudden they're here to tell her these things. And so, however, she has her first taste of what the cross will really be. See, at this point, she still has no idea of the cross. Remember that. Elizabeth nor the angel have mentioned anything about that. And in Jewish expectation, although, yes, there's the prophecy sitting there of the suffering servant and everything else, they know that. But in their heightened expectation, it's kind of like you forget those passages. Like we do today, right? We always like to forget the inconvenient passages for whatever's going on in our life right now. So we don't want to, like, obey those ones or think about them. Well, Israel, the same way. They tended to set those ones to the side. They focused on the stories of the Messiah and his glory and left behind all the other sides. So Mary's slowly putting this all together, however, though. The Magi, there's not really, other than the fact that they're still at a house and things in Bethlehem when she comes, there's not a lot to cover there specifically, because the more important event is coming up now, this circumcision and the purification. Here we again see the devotion and devoutness of the Holy Family. The Torah, if you turn to page 30, when God makes his promise to Abraham, so again, we're going back to Abraham. Remember, everything keeps going back to David, Abraham. I'm trying to sort of ingrain that in you so you become more Jewish in your thinking. Pope Pius XII said, spiritually, Christians are all Semites. What he means is everything we believe, think, and feel religiously comes from a Jewish point of view.